Hello, dear friends. Pastor Dan here. You know, we're getting close now to closing out the Christmas season. We got a couple of days to go, and as I mentioned to you last week, I wanted to bring you one more Christmas message and give you the opportunity, hopefully, that you would sing along with us as we do one last Christmas carol. And as I told you last week, that would be O Little Town of Bethlehem. And so, dear friends, if you know it, sing along with us. If you don't know it, hum along with us. Or just let the words minister to your heart. If I was in a church building, I'd be saying, we're going to do the first and last verse, but that's what we're going to be doing. So please join us as we sing O Little Town of Bethlehem. You'll hear our little trio again with our piano accompaniment.
Still we see thee lie above thy deep and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. It can only be Jesus. It means God with us. Now, as always, I'm so grateful that you're joining with us today. And as we gather around God's holy word, the only word of truth. Now, I want to welcome you if you're joining us for the first time. And dear friends, if you're blessed, if you're uplifted, or even challenged by our study today, then I invite you to click onto that like button, subscribe, and that way you'll always know when we're going to do a new study. And by the way, while you're there, you might want to click onto that little share button, invite a friend, a family member, maybe even a former friend, and maybe today, in this season, to maybe share with them a little Christmas joy as we encounter together the ever infallible, unveiling truth of God's sacred and holy word. And dear friends, that reality, the sacredness of his word, the holiness of his word, becomes even more important during this Christmas season. For as a born-again child of God, we do not now or ever celebrate a government holiday. We celebrate the day. The day, as Philippians 2, 5, and 7 tells us, God took on the form of man and dwelt among his people, dwelt among the creation that he loves, to give them what no government edict can ever give or take away, saving grace, joy that is unspeakable and full of glory, and peace in fellowship with God and with one another. Now, I suppose, with that being true, if I were to give today's message a name, it would be somewhere along the lines of Christmas with Isaiah. And that being true, our text today is twofold. First of all, it's Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, and then chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. In chapter 7, verse 14, it says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, being God with us. And then in chapter 9, we read in verses 6 and 7, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Now, Isaiah 7 and 14 is a prime example. that prophecy can have an unfolding fulfillment. In other words, it's not uncommon for biblical prophecy to have one level of fulfillment in the immediate future and then a final fulfillment many years later, as in the person and work of Jesus Christ. There are some people today who believe that Isaiah 7:14 finds its fulfillment in the wife of King Ahaz, whom God had rejected as king, and his son Hezekiah, who succeeded him. But events did not show that God was with this family or blessing them in any way. Now, there are others who believe that the woman mentioned is Isaiah's wife, the prophetess of chapter 8, verse 3, and the son mentioned being that of Isaiah. But each of these possibilities could have been a fulfillment, but not the fulfillment. According to Matthew 1 and 22, only Jesus Christ could be the fulfillment of this prophecy, given some 755 years before his birth. Matthew writes, "All this was done," speaking of all the events surrounding the birth and naming of Jesus, "all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet Isaiah, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel," which is translated, God with us. Now, this is an example of Scripture being the best authority of the meaning of Scripture. You need to know the Hebrew word for virgin, as you may recall I mentioned to you last week, is alma, and it suggests a young woman of marrying age, and by implication, a virgin. Youthfulness is the focus of the term, and as you know, the virgin or young woman spoken of was a young teenager. And given the fact that the text refuses to identify her and only tells us she is young, will become pregnant and name her child Emmanuel, God with us, it seems evident that the child's name is a significant part of this sign and verse, not the unknown young woman becoming pregnant. Now, while it is, as I said, possible for prophecy to have multiple fulfillments with one focal fulfillment, Scripture does not seem to point in that direction with this verse. The prophecy of Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 is viewed as fulfilled only in the birth of Jesus. Mary, of course, was the Virgin Mother. The birth of Jesus was the sign of God's salvation. Now, because Jesus was the Son of God and lived among us, according to Matthew 1:23, his name would be Emmanuel, as we said, meaning God with us. Accordingly, Isaiah's prophecy in verse 14 had no fulfillment prior to Jesus' birth. And we can see that in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. And you must never forget, Colossians 2:9 tells us, in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And so we see God with us fulfilled in the coming of God's only Son to the earth. He is the only child, the only given Son that could fulfill this prophecy. And as God's only begotten or unique Son, he's also the only child who could, as Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 tells us, be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Now, these names or titles given him serve to help us understand God's gracious and loving purpose for us. You know, in our society, names don't mean that much. Sometimes we can find them in a book. We use them merely as labels to identify one person in contrast to another, but that wasn't the case in the land and time of Jesus. Names were significant. Names would express gratitude. Names could express hope or even a prayer. Occasionally, a child would be given a name of prophetic significance. Sometimes were deeply religious, and others spoke of some spiritual experience encountered with God. Here in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 of Isaiah, the title given to the coming Savior contains a revelation of his person, of his character, and of his purpose towards humanity. These names or titles, as all others, become part of the self-revelation by which at sundry times and in diverse manners God leads his people into the knowledge of himself. And so we read in chapter 9, verse 6, "For unto us is born a child, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Now, the first two lines of this first verse set in place the greatest Christmas of all. First of all, the child is born into humanity to walk among us and be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. It is as we see in John 1:14, where it says that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Now, as God's only unique Son, He is freely given to us, indicating as a gift, He must be received and He must be accepted. He has been given to us to be all that our fallen state demanded and all our redeemed state requires. It is as the angels announced in heavenly chorus, "Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." And in this case, the word Lord is Kurios, and it refers to God. He is God with us, and the government shall be upon His shoulder. The government is His authority. It's His empire and eternal kingdom. As the one who rules, all that His kingdom entails will rest on His shoulders. The very same shoulders that carried the weight of the cross now carries the weight of His government. He is the only one who could bear it and uphold it. So is it any wonder that Revelations 19 and 16 tells us He has on His robe and on His thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. As supreme ruler, the names given Him emphasize His wisdom, emphasize His absolute deity, His eternal being, and His work as the Prince of Peace. Jesus Christ is the only one in all of history and knowledge of man to whom these titles, these names, can properly and fully apply. So in verse 6 it says again, "And His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor." You should know that in the original Hebrew, there is no comma between the two words, Wonderful and Counselor. So with the remaining three titles, each consisting of two words, it is believed the most appropriate reading would be Wonderful Counselor as one name. And this ties it into the predominant pattern of the remaining names, giving us four, not five titles. But inasmuch as most translations render them as five titles, I'll approach them from that perspective. But you should know, in the original, the title Wonderful Counselor is one title, not two. So with that, we see His name shall be called Wonderful. You might find it interesting to know the Greek means a marvelous thing, a wonder. There's an old Celtic proverb that describes our Savior as a wonder of wonders, and every wonder is true. God the Father has done and is doing wonderful things for us in and through Jesus Christ. For example, He is wonderful in His grace as well as His greatness. He came on a mission of grace to meet the deepest needs in the hearts and lives of all humanity. And that includes each of you hearing me today, wherever you may be. And with that name, Great Grace, with that same great grace, He continues to work wonders in the lives of those who trust Him. He is wonderful in His mercy as well as His majesty. He who was sinless became sin for us. Why? That we might become the righteousness of God in Him. He came to bring mercy and forgiveness into the hearts and lives of people like you and like me who were alienated from God. And with great majesty, He marched toward the cross and the tomb. And with the wonder of divine power, He conquered death and the grave to be our Savior and bring us the hope of resurrection and reunited family ties. He is wonderful in His patience as well as in His power. With His infinite patience, He works in the hearts and lives of those who trust in Him to produce miracles of grace. And during this Christmas season, you need to know and rejoice in the knowledge that the creative, redeeming power of God was upon Him, continues on this very day and this very moment to flow from Him into our hearts, into the hearts of those who respond to His love. In the early 1900s, a poet named Charles Gabriel came face to face with this wonderful gift of love in Christ. And he responded by writing, "I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how He could love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love to me." Anyone who would express any less awe than that has not yet been in his presence, has not yet encountered his love. To experience his salvation is to know he is wonderful because of who he is. After the Christmas holiday, a lot of people who acknowledge the name of Jesus on Christmas, except for their favorite expletives, will simply fall back into their customary silence about him. They don't personally know this babe of Bethlehem. Who is this Jesus Christ whose birth we'll celebrate on December 25th, just a couple of days from now? Is he to be thought of only as the best man who ever lived on earth? He was, and is that. Are we to think of him only as a remarkable teacher who taught with such authority that even the temple guards said of him in John 7:46, no man ever spoke like this man? Because the words that fell from Christ's lips contain divine truth. They continue to live and bless the lives of all people willing to hear him. Hopefully that's you today. He said, heaven and earth will pass away, but listen, my words, he said, abides forever. He is wonderful because of what he can do for you. At one time or another, all of us are indebted to others who have and who will continue to render valuable service and favors to us. Most of us owe a debt of gratitude to former teachers. I had a wonderful music teacher that I'll always remember named Mr. Robert Clark. Debt to families, physicians, friends, family members, anyone who might have assisted us in a time of need. And believe it or not, even parents. But it is to Jesus Christ that we owe our greatest debt of gratitude. For what he has done for us goes on and on and on. It is the one gift that just keeps on giving. He alone can and does forgive your every sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. He alone can and will bestow upon you the wonderful gift of eternal life with him and renewed life with loved ones who have joined him before us. He alone can provide you day by day with divine guidance and help as you face whatever your future holds. And in that respect, his name should be called Counselor. You need to know he's competent to be your counselor because of who he is, what he's done, and the resources of divine wisdom and knowledge residing in him. It is through this Savior born in a manger that God has given us his counsel. He is the wisdom of the Father imparted to us. Jesus Christ is a compassionate, consistent counselor. He's a true and confidential counselor to whom we can confess our sins in the confidence that he will forgive and that our confidence in him will never be betrayed. Because Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. He's constantly present to be your counselor. You don't have to take a number. You don't even have to make an appointment. He's ever present. If you'll take the time to open his pages, he'll counsel you by means of the scriptures you read, the scriptures you memorize and hide away in your heart. He'll counsel you by means of his church and the sermons you hear, the songs you sing. And if you listen, he offers counsel in the quietness of your prayer time. Jesus is a living Savior and counselor who comes to dwell in the heart of every true believer in the person of the Holy Spirit, as John 14:16-18 tells us. Any counsel given and followed has consequences, and sometimes not to our liking. But Christ's counsel will always provide us with invaluable assistance in our quest for proper and consistent Christian conduct. And by heeding his counsel, our chance of a complete conformity to the mind and the spirit of Christ is greatly enhanced. Perhaps his greatest counsel for life was said in Matthew 28, where he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you will find rest unto your souls. He is the wonderful counselor, and his name should be called Mighty God. In the Hebrew, the word mighty means warrior. So Jesus Christ is a mighty warrior. And as our mighty God, Hebrews 7:25 tells us, he is able to save, he's able to deliver and protect to the uttermost or completely save those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. and as our mighty God. He overcame Satan in his wilderness temptation and experience. And as our mighty God, he overcame the world by his sinless life. And as our mighty God, he overcame the flesh in the Garden of Gethsemane. As our mighty God, he overcame sin on the cross. And as our mighty God, he overcame death and the grave in the resurrection. His name stands for his person, his power, and his redeeming work amongst us. He can convert the hardest heart and provide grace for the weakest sinner. And one day he's coming again, and he will raise the dead, judge the world, and ultimately destroy sin and its prince. His name shall be called Mighty God, and as such he can be called no less than Everlasting Father. This babe that we sang about, this babe of Bethlehem, is the Everlasting Father, or the Father of eternity. He is God, God with us. He's one with the Father who is from everlasting to everlasting. You need to know to be called Everlasting Father is to be characterized by eternity and refers to Christ's lordship of eternity. The title Everlasting Father is an emphatic assertion of his messianic deity. It distinctly sets him apart from sinful man whose life, Scripture tells us, is but a vapor that appears for a while and then fades away, as seen in James chapter 4, verse 14. Jesus Christ is the Everlasting Father because he is the giver of eternal life. This promised Messiah, this child born unto us, this son given unto us, is the Everlasting Father providing for his own. He provides tender, loving care and faithfully abides with those who trust him and work to carry out his purpose. Being the Everlasting Father, we are assured he will never vacate his office. It is as he said to the Apostle John in Revelation 1:18, I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. This Savior, whom we worship at Christmas time, did not come into existence the time of his birth in Bethlehem. He always was, and he always will be. In Bethlehem, the eternal God clothed himself in the garments of human flesh, that we might better understand the nature and character of God the Father. What the Savior was, he is, and shall forever be. He continues to be the Everlasting Father in his ability and availability to meet the deepest needs of the human heart. As the Father of eternity, he ever lives to bestow on you the gift of eternal life, a life that is far more than endless duration. It's a new quality of life, the very life of God. And if you'll recognize him, if you'll respond to him, this can be and will be the most wonderful Christmas season of all, a time of deepest peace of heart and mind. His name shall be called the Prince of Peace. Now, the casual reader will miss it, but you need not. You should notice that each of Christ's names or titles mentioned in our text contains a divine promise. In the title Prince of Peace, we see the highest title of all. In this capacity, he is the answer to the heart's deepest need. The magnitude of his task in our lives is revealed in this title. He alone makes it possible for all mankind to be at peace with God and to live at peace with one another. To live at peace with one another. You know, it's a sad truth. With all our vast knowledge, we failed and are failing to achieve a world at peace, and for that matter, a country at peace. Knowledge without heart is as useless as words without heart in establishing anything of lasting duration and meaning. With all our knowledge, we've achieved the highest standard of living in the world, and in our greed have placed it in jeopardy, and there remains an obvious absence of peace. With all our knowledge and artificial substitutes for the Prince of Peace, we cannot quiet the turmoil that exists in the human heart. With all our knowledge, all our artificial substitutes for the Prince of Peace, we cannot quiet the turmoil that exists in the human heart. Lasting peace is the gift of God. And that's why even the priests in the Old Testament were instructed to bless the people with a benediction of peace, saying, "The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee. The Lord give thee peace." The psalmist recognized peace as one of the blessings of God. In Psalms 29:11, he said, "The Lord will bless his people with peace." Even Isaiah, our prophet of the day, perceived that true peace comes from a surrender of one's life to the will of God. He said in Isaiah 26:3, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect or complete peace whose mind is stayed or leaning on you, because he trusts in you." Do you trust in him today? The Apostle Paul believed that the Heavenly Father is the giver of peace and said in 2 Thessalonians 3:16, "Now the Lord of peace himself give you peace always in every way. The Lord be with you." On the night this Prince of Peace was born in Bethlehem, the angels of heaven proclaimed the original Hallelujah chorus, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of good will." The Christmas season, more than any other, should be a time of peace. But in our society, it's chaos, with people looking to government to solve economic problems government created in the first place through their own greed and their own lack of oversight. And so our government offers no peace, and it will never offer peace. You have to know Jesus Christ is the only source of real and lasting peace. Romans 5:1 tells you, "Peace is the blessing he died to purchase for you." We're told that being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we also have access by faith into his grace, in which we stand and rejoice in hope and glory of God. And John 20:21 tells you, "Peace is the blessing he lives to bestow upon you." It is as Jesus said. Listen, Jesus said, "My peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives do I give unto you." The world can give just as fast as it can take away. But Jesus' peace abides with you forever. Jesus' joy abides with you forever. Jesus' love abides with you forever. Nothing, no edict, nothing can take that away from you. You can walk away from it. You can surrender it. But it is always there for you. Prince of Peace. He offers you peace from God and gives you peace with God. His peace is not the peace of stagnation or inactivity. He does not calm us with a spiritual narcotic to keep us from facing reality. This Christmas season, whatever the reality of your life is, as the Prince of Peace, and as I said, he offers you peace from God and gives you peace with God. His peace is the peace of surrender to the rule of love. His peace is the peace of fellowship with God the Father. His peace is the peace of assurance that your sins have been forgiven and forgotten. You need to know with his presence, it is possible for one to walk with poise, for one to walk with dignity in the midst of all life's storms, all of life's calamity, all of life's sorrow. And this Christmas, no matter what position, no matter what situation you find yourself in, I invite you to consider the King of Kings. Consider this Prince of Peace, the one that Revelation 19:6 tells us is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. As the Prince of Peace, he creates and preserves peace in your life. It is as Isaiah tells us in verse 7 of chapter 9, "Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end." And if you allow him to be, he is your peace. So today God has spoken to us through Isaiah and presented us with the ultimate Christmas gift. He has presented us with a newborn child. He has given us a son. He has declared him to be our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. It's all there. It's all there for you. And you'll never have to go Christmas shopping to get it. It's already been purchased. It's already been prepared. It's already been delivered. And happy holidays can never provide it. It's just up to you to accept the gift that keeps on giving. And always, year after year, truly have yourself a very merry Christmas season. Let us pray. Father, we're grateful that in the last couple of weeks we've been able to share your word as it relates to this holiday that we celebrate, Christmas. We're so grateful, oh Father God, that no man can take that away from us because you have given it to us. And so we reach out with the truth of your word that this babe and born in Bethlehem was born the Savior. He was born a King of kings and Lord of lords, and he alone can provide all the needs and desires of the human heart. And dear friend, if you're out there this Christmas season, no matter where you're at, if you're alone, you find yourself without this joy, without this peace, without this love, without this Jesus, you know, it's very simple. All he asks of you is to acknowledge him, to accept him, to love him as he has always loved you. And so with that, if that's your desire this Christmas day, that you'll never be alone again, as you'll always know you are loved, then I invite you to say this prayer with me. Father God, thank you for sending Jesus to forgive my sins, to cover my sins, to fill me with your love and your grace. Oh, Father God, I surrender my life to you. I acknowledge that I am a sinner, but more importantly, as I accept Jesus into my life, I am a sinner saved by grace, your grace. And as I ask you, Jesus, to be my Savior, I surrender my life to you that you may be my Lord. And I promise to walk in this life, letting you live your life through me. And for that, I am eternally grateful. Give you thanks in Jesus' name. And dear friends, I hope today's study has been a blessing to you. And if that prayer was your prayer today, then please know, please believe that inasmuch as you've surrendered your life to Jesus and you've invited him to come in and take control as Lord and Savior of your life, Jesus has a promise for you this Christmas season and every season. And you can see it in Revelation 3:21, where he says, "Listen, I stand at the door and knock. If any man or person or woman, child, if anyone hears my voice or my word, opens that door as you have, the door of your heart, I will come into him, dine with him, have fellowship with him or her, and he with me." Dear friend, that speaks of a rich, everlasting fellowship with him that only grows sweeter as the days go by, and yes, even as the years go by, and as you immerse yourself in the Word of God and the fellowship of prayer. So with that in mind, I hope you'll join with us next time as we once again together gather around God's Word, because as I always say, I believe God the Father has something special for us. But until then, God bless, and Merry Christmas.